Welcome to The Long Way Around. I'm your host, Malcolm Byrne, and you are listening to Radio Kingston. The Long Way Around is coming to you live on the radio where anything can happen, and it's always fun. I'm going to start off a little piece of music that my grandmother used to sing, or actually my mom used to sing, and then I'll segue into the show. Et decorum est by Wilfred Owen. Bent double like old beggars under sacks, knock-kneed, coughing like hags, we cursed through sludge, till on the haunting flares we turned our backs, and towards our distant rest began to trudge. Men marched to sleep, many lost their boots, but limped on, bloodshod, all went lame, all blind, drunk with fatigue, deaf even to the hoots of tired, outstripped five nines that dropped. Gas, gas, quick, boys, an ecstasy of fumbling, fitting the clumsy helmets just in time, but someone still was yelling out and stumbling and floundering like a man in fire or lime. Dim through the musty panes and thick green light, as under a green sea, I saw him drowning. In all my dreams, before my helpless sight, he plunges at me, guttering, choking, drowning. If in some smothering dreams you too could pace behind that wagon we flung him in and watch the white eyes writhing in his face, his hanging face, like a devil's, sick of sin. If you could hear at every jolt the blood come gargling from the froth, corrupted lungs, obscene as cancer, bitter as the cud of vile, incurable sores on innocent tongues. My friend, you would not tell with such high zest to children ardent for some desperate glory the old lie, dulce est decorum est pro patria mori. That poem was written in 1918, several months before Wilfred Owen was killed in France during the First World War. And it's one of the great poems, became one of the great anti-war poems, I should say, of the 20th century. And as the world sort of teeters on the brink of yet another world war, it's interesting to remind ourselves that perhaps those words need remembering again. So when we have Remembrance Day, let's try and remember what we're actually supposed to be remembering. going to read an excerpt from a book called To End All Wars by Adam Hochschild. It's from the foreword of the book. And he says, what kings and prime ministers did not foresee, many more far-sighted citizens did from the beginning. Tens of thousands of people on both sides recognized the war for the catastrophe it was. This is the First World War we're talking about. They believed it was not worth the inevitable cost in blood. Some of them anticipated with tragic clarity at least part of the nightmare that would engulf Europe as a result, and they spoke out. Moreover, they spoke out at a time when it took great courage to do so, for the air was filled with fervent nationalism and a scorn for dissenters that often turned violent. A handful of German parliamentarians bravely opposed war credits, and radicals like Rosa Luxemburg and Karl Liebknecht later went to prison, as did the American socialist leader Eugene V. Debs. But it was in Britain more than anywhere else that significant numbers of intrepid war correspondents acted on their beliefs and paid the price. By the conflict's end, more than 20,000 British men of military age had refused the draft. Many refused non-combatant alternative service too, and more than 6,000 served prison terms under harsh conditions. Hard labor, a bare-bones diet, a strict rule of silence that forbade them from talking to one another. Before it became clear just how many Britons would refuse to fight, some 50 early resistors were forcibly inducted into the army and transported, some in handcuffs, across the English Channel to France. A few weeks before that famous first day on the Somme, a less known scene unfolded at a British army camp not far away, with the sound of artillery fire from the front. The group of war opponents was told that if they continued to disobey orders, they would be sentenced to death. In an act of great collective courage that echoed down through the years, not a single man wavered. Only at the last minute, thanks to frantic lobbying in London, were their lives saved. These resistors and their comrades did not come close to stopping the war and have won no place in the standard history books, but their strength of conviction remains one of the glories of a dark time. It's often said that past wars are unjust. Mistakes shouldn't have been fought. We only have to go back 20 years to think about the beginning of the war with Iraq, Afghanistan. Go back another 2 decades to the first war in Iraq, the first Gulf War. We can go back to the Vietnam War and the Second World War. But somehow the wars that are in the present always seem like the right wars, the just wars. And it's always the leader of some country that is now portrayed as the new Hitler, the new arch enemy that we always seem to need. And that's my categorization of what's currently happening with this so-called war with Ukraine, which is in fact a proxy war between the United States and Russia, which is quickly turning into a hot war with now American soldiers in Ukraine, on the front lines, directly confronting Russian soldiers. And there's much talk of this turning into a nuclear conflagration. And my opinion is that the only way that would happen would be if we in the West decided to use nuclear weapons. I don't see the Russians doing it. There's no point. The weapons that they now have are precise. Nuclear weapons are actually tactically outdated. So you can stick that in your hat and smoke it, New York Times, CNN, and all the rest of you, because there's very few reporters on the front lines actually telling us what's really going on. They're all sitting behind the front lines, pretending that they're reporting from the front lines. Anyway, I'm going to play a selection of music tonight. This is a very anti-war show, and sorry, I apologize for the slightly rough ending and beginning of the show, but I thought this piece of music would be appropriate. It's one of my favorite pieces. It's the fourth movement from Symphony No. 5 in C sharp minor by Gustav Mahler. And I think it's a very anti-war sentiment somehow in this piece of music. So we'll be back in about 10 minutes or so.
Thank you.
Symphony number 5 in C sharp minor by Gustav Mahler. I think probably one of the most beautiful pieces of music I've ever heard in my life. And I'm glad I play it fairly often on the show. And it's kind of a remedy for all the hate going on in the world. I'll be right back after this message. Stay tuned.
What does community radio mean to you?
Community radio means, to me, it's a way that we can take care of ourselves, because we take care of ourselves, we protect ourselves, and we have to take care of each other. So community radio, to me, is a way that we look out for one another.
Radio Kingston.
Many voices, one community.
Hi, I'm Ann Hutton from Jim and Lisa's Circle Home. Our beautiful comfort care home in the Rondout Historic District is soon to be open, welcoming hospice-enrolled folks who need a safe and comfy place to live out their last days. Hudson Valley Hospice will extend services to our residents who may not be able to remain in their own homes or whose support system no longer works for them. But the 24/7 care they'll get from us will also benefit their families and friends. Our home is an alternative to expensive private or institutional care settings, and it will cost our residents nothing. Together, we're breaking down the prevailing notion that death is an unnatural event that must be hidden away. If you'd like to learn how you can be involved, we have volunteer training sessions in December and January. To learn more or sign up, click Get Involved at circlehome.org.
And it's my turn to do some talking. Let's see, the Center for Creative Education is hosting their third annual Thanksgiving Spread the Love event Thursday, November 24th. In the spirit of community giving, there will be free food, clothing, resources, and live entertainment. Delivery of items is also available to those who would benefit but cannot attend in person. With the help of the community, local nonprofits, and local businesses, CCE plans to feed over 1,000 families in and around Kingston and Ulster County. CCE is also looking for volunteers, donors, and sponsors to make this event as successful as possible. The third annual Thanksgiving Spread the Love, Thursday, November 24th, from 10 a.m. to 3 p.m. at the Center for Creative Education, 16 Cedar Street in Kingston. For more education or to volunteer, donate, or sponsor, visit ccefor.me.org. And you are listening to The Long Way Round with me, your host, Malcolm Byrne, and I'm here by myself, unusual as that may seem, after the past months of having many, many guests. I don't know if you heard last week's show, the interview with Rossi Indira from Indonesia, Andre Vilcek's wife. It was a very, very enlightening interview, and thank you, Rossi, and thank you to Liz Hill, as always, for being a wonderful producer. This show is dedicated to my grandfather, who fought in the First World War, and I never knew him, but my father told me some stories. One of the things that my grandfather rarely did was talk about his experiences, which is not unusual for people who lived through those times, unlike Wilfred Owen, of course. And I draw certain parallels. Chris Hedges termed it war psychosis, and there seems to be a bit of that going on these days. Not that there aren't always conflicts going on, but the current conflict in Ukraine is particularly worrisome, because it's the first time in a very long time that two nuclear-armed countries have essentially sort of stopped talking to one another, and both sides are claiming that there's only one way forward, and that is to achieve victory. And as Noam Chomsky says, inevitably the result of wars is, and ultimately end up in negotiations. It's unavoidable. And at what point would negotiations occur? We don't know. But in the meantime, America is conducting what I call, and many other people call, a proxy war. And there is many people that I admire, and friends who seem to support this idea that somehow or other Russians are no longer human beings and Vladimir Putin is the next Hitler. And I find that very difficult to understand and very hard to imagine, although I'm not exposed to the endless propaganda that most people probably are, because I simply tune out most mainstream media, including the New York Times and the Washington Post, which are essentially just mouthpieces for the State Department, kind of churning out endless nonsense geared up to continue the arms, I don't know what it is. It's like some kind of bonanza, because you can look at Wall Street and you see the share prices are all going up for companies like McDonnell Douglas and Raytheon, the arms manufacturers. Meanwhile, you know, countries like Germany are facing a very catastrophic situation. We blew up their pipeline. It's undeniable that somebody on our side did that. The idea that the Russians did that is completely absurd. So now Germany, you know, for the first time in many, many years, is no longer talking directly to Russia, which is a very dangerous situation indeed. And then you have other countries like Poland sort of wanting to go all in for it. And then you have Nazis, actual Nazis in Ukraine that we are funding and paying for. And that's a very disturbing feeling to understand that. So there's a lot to talk about on this show, but I'll probably only get to a bit of it. But I'd prefer to remain on the humane human side. I'm going to play, this is a little excerpt. This was recorded in 1918. And it's the actual sound of British troops firing gas shells onto the German lines during the First World War. I don't know what particular battle this may have been, but anyway, here you go. So I'll follow that up with an excerpt from a book by one of my other favorite First World War writers, Ernst Jünger.
And reactor, 176, 106. Elevator, 25 degrees. Gas cell, 106.2. Gas cell, 106.2. HC Dark Guard 4, loading report.
That was the First World War, when it seemed that human beings couldn't outdo themselves with ways of killing other human beings. And it's only gotten worse since then. I'm going to read an excerpt from the other side of the lines during the First World War. One of my favorite books to come out of that conflict is a book by a very, very well-known German writer, Ernst Jünger. Ernst Jünger was served in the First World War as a German soldier. He went on to be a fairly well-acclaimed science fiction writer, but I'm going to read the very, very, very end of his book, Storm of Steel, which is not a sad, sentimental book. In fact, it's quite the opposite. It really kind of just gives you a sense of the endless storm of steel, which the First World War was. Not, of course, not to be outdone, but the United States probably dropped more bombs on Cambodia in 5 days than were dropped in the entire First World War, but we'll leave that little conversation to another time. So this is the very end of the book. Younger finds himself at the end of the war in a convalescent home after being wounded. And these are his final words to his book. He says, "During the endless hours flat on your back, you try to distract yourself to pass the time. Once I reckoned up my wounds. Leaving out trifles such as ricochets and grazes, I was hit at least 14 times, these being 5 bullets, 2 shell splinters, 1 shrapnel ball, 4 hand grenade splinters, and 2 bullet splinters, which, with entry and exit wounds, left me with an even 20 scars. In the course of this war, where so much of the firing was done blindly into empty space, I still managed to get myself targeted no fewer than 11 times. I felt every justification, therefore, in donning the gold wound stripes, which arrived for me one day. A fortnight later, I was lying on the rumbling bed of a hospital train. The German landscape was already bathed in the luster of early autumn. I was fortunate enough to be taken off the train at Hanover and was put in the Clementine infirmary. Among the visitors who soon arrived, I was particularly glad to see my brother. He had continued to grow since his wounding, although his right side, which was where he was hurt, hadn't. I shared my room with a young fighter pilot from Richthofen's squadron, a man named Wenzel, one of the tall and fearless types our nation still produces. He lived up to the motto of his squadron, hard and crazy with it, and had already brought down a dozen opponents in single combat, although the last had splintered his upper arm with a bullet first. The first time I went out, I went with him, my brother and a few comrades who were waiting their transport to the rooms of the old Hanoverian Gibraltar Regiment. Since our war worthiness was being put into question, we felt the urgent need to prove ourselves by vaulting an enormous armchair. We didn't do too well. Wenzel broke his arm all over again, and the following day I was back in bed with a temperature of 40. Yes, my chart even threatened the red line beyond which the doctors are powerless to help. At such high temperatures, you lose your sense of time. While the sisters were fighting for my life, I was in those fever dreams that are often very amusing. On one of those days, it was 22nd of September 1918, I received the following telegram from General von Busse. His Majesty the Kaiser has bestowed on you the Order pour le Mérite in the name of the whole division. I congratulate you. Yes, Germans are human beings too, and so are Russians. We all bleed, and we all live, and we all die. Here's a piece by Sebastian Bach, which I'll prelude into my next reading. This is the first piece from the Goldberg Variations. after these messages. Radio Kingston.
Many voices.
Many voices.
Many voices, one community.
Hi, I'm Nick Pankin. Join me for Freedom Highway, Sunday nights from 10 to midnight here on Radio Kingston. We're a musical inquiry into where each of us fits into the established order.
What are you doing toward the scheme of things?
Which side are you on, my people? Which side are you on?
Which side are you on, boys? Which side are you on?
We're listening to songs that give voice to the ongoing struggle and our hopes to create a world that belongs to all people. Freedom Highway, Sunday nights from 10 to midnight here on Radio Kingston, AM 1490, FM 1079, and anytime at radiokingston.org.
Hi, I'm Rachel Tantillo from RUPCO. At RUPCO, we work hard to create homes, support people, and improve communities. We provide a wide array of programs and services to our community, including homebuyer education and grants to purchase your first home. We offer foreclosure prevention counseling, we administer Section 8 rental assistance, and we manage over 700 units of affordable rental housing. And we're developing new innovative affordable housing opportunities in our area through historic preservation and new construction. For more information about what RUPCO can do for you, call 845-331-2140 or visit rupco.org.
Radio Kingston.
Muchas voces.
Many voices.
One community.
Hi, I'm Carmel Holt. Join me for Shiro's Radio, Monday nights from 10 to midnight, here on Radio Kingston.
We didn't understand this need for a space that was all women.
We're amplifying and celebrating women and gender-expansive folks in music across genres and generations.
There's so many other spaces that are like patriarchal. We need our own.
I need to be around my women. It's very different to have space with women on the road. And I love that I have these women with me, and this is who I'm moving through the world with.
We're turning up the volume of women's voices in song and conversation.
I'm not just making records. I want, if the world ended, somebody to find these records and have a very good understanding of what was happening at that time.
That's Shiro's Radio, Monday nights from 10 to midnight, here at Radio Kingston, AM 1490, FM 1079, and anytime at radiokingston.org.
To the victors go the spoils, and the victors, of course, always get to write the history books. And we get to read them. And what we read, we believe. Because we believe what we read. And then we find out many years later that what we believe is often unbelievable. I myself was brought up with a certain view of the Second World War as being a good war, fought by good people against very, very bad people. That it was a great and necessary conflict. And that had we not fought that war, we would all be goose-stepping around, and those of us who didn't agree would be in concentration camps. That may or may not be true. But the reality is that one of the greatest atrocities of the Second World War was perpetrated by the Allies, by the United States and Britain. It was during the firebombing of Dresden, which was a city, it is a city in Germany, which towards the end of the war was, Dresden had no military significance. It was not a place that had any in particular industrialization. It wasn't a military target. It was a civilian target. And by the end of the war, the target was the civilians of Germany. It was a all-out war, total war. And there's a fellow by the name of Bomber Harris. Him and one of our fellows, whose name escapes me, came up with this concept of what they called firebombing, where they would bomb a target with incendiary bombs and create what's known as a firestorm. And the firestorm, once it would be ignited, would become a force of its own, create a great sucking vacuum and suck every living thing into it. And Dresden at this point was not only home to many German refugees, there was also people who had been liberated from concentration camps, Jews and non-Jews. There was Soviet prisoners of war. There was even Allied soldiers. And the city was turned into a giant raging inferno. People were found later who had tried to find refuge. They sought refuge in things like water tanks. They were boiled alive. And it was one of the great atrocities of the Second World War, that and the bombings of Hiroshima and Nagasaki. And those were done in the name of democracy and freedom and corporate interests, much not unlike what is currently going on in Ukraine at the moment. And one of the great books to come out of the Second World War was a book by Kurt Vonnegut Jr., one of my favorite science fiction writers. He wrote a book, and I saw the film when I was about 12 years old. It was called Slaughterhouse-5. The score was done by Glenn Gould, which is why I played that Goldberg Variations. And it's a very interesting book, but I'm going to read you one of my favorite passages from the book. And it's sort of a kind of a, I don't know, you judge for yourself. It says, "It was a movie about American bombers in World War II and the gallant men who flew them. Seen backwards by Billy, who was the hero of the book, the story went like this. American planes full of holes and wounded men and corpses took off backwards from an airfield in England. Over France, a few German fighter planes flew at them backwards, sucked bullets and shell fragments from some of the planes and crewmen. They did the same for the wrecked American bombers on the ground, and those planes flew up backwards to join the formation. The formation flew backwards over a German city that was in flames. The bombers opened their bomb bay doors, exerted a miraculous magnetism which shrunk the fires, gathered them into cylindrical steel containers, and lifted the containers into the bellies of the planes. The containers were stored neatly in racks. The Germans below had miraculous devices of their own, which were long steel tubes. They used them to suck more fragments from the crewmen and planes, but there were still a few wounded Americans, though, and some of the bombers were in bad repair. Over France, though, German fighters came up again, made everything and everybody as good as new. When the bombers got back to their base, the steel cylinders were taken from the racks and shipped back to the United States of America, where factories were operating night and day, dismantling the cylinders, separating the dangerous contents into minerals. Touchingly, it was mainly women who did this work. The minerals were then shipped to specialists in remote areas. It was their business to put them into the ground, to hide them cleverly, so they would never hurt anybody ever again." That's Kurt Vonnegut from Slaughterhouse 5. And this next piece of music is, again, one of my favorite pieces of music. It's very mournful and tragic, but it was written, it was a piece of music by, originally written by a fellow named Tommaso Albinoni during the Italian great era of Verdi and so forth. And the piece of music, the manuscript was kept in a stored in Dresden during the war, and during the firebombing, it was partially destroyed, as was the building that contained the manuscript. And it was found and resuscitated and kind of partially rewritten. And the piece is somehow very appropriate for that great tragedy of Dresden. So I'm going to play that for you now. This is Adagio for Strings and Organ in G Minor by Tommaso Albinoni.
Thank you.
Read an excerpt from one of my current favorite books called Exposing Lies of the Empire by Andrei Vilcek, one of the great anti-war writers. And in the beginning of his book, he writes, "The mass media monopolizes the coverage of most important, the most explosive topics of the day, the wars, occupations, and the horrors that billions of people of the world have to suffer as a result of our neo-colonialist regime and its market fundamentalism. Independent reporters are not being hired anymore. Those who are still around and working are well tested, and even then the numbers are much smaller than several decades ago. It all makes sense. The coverage of conflicts is at the core of the ideological battle, and the propaganda mechanism of the Western globally imposed regime is fully in control of it. Naturally, it would be naive to believe that the mainstream media and academia are not essential parts of the system. To understand the world in depth, one has to be familiar with the plights and horrors of war and conflict zones. That's where colonialism and neocolonialism show their awful and sharp teeth. And by conflict zones, I don't only mean the places that are bombed from the air and shelled by artillery. There are conflict zones where tens of thousands, even millions of people are dying as a result of sanctions, misery, or internal battles fueled from the outside, like in the present-day Syria. In the past, the best coverage of such conflicts was done by independent reporters, most of them coming from the ranks of progressive writers and independent thinkers. The stories and images of the wars, coups, and plight of refugees were on the daily menu served with eggs and cereals to the citizenry of the culprit countries. That's by Andrei Vilcek from Exposing Lies of the Empire. Going to just do a little station ID, and we'll be right back with hour two. Stay tuned.
From our studio in Midtown, this is Radio Kingston, WKNY, AM 1490, FM 1079, Kingston, New York.
When I was fairly young, my family spent the summer in Heidelberg, Germany. And at that time, I was a young man who was kind of obsessed with, like a lot of young boys, with war, especially Germans. When I was a kid, I just thought their uniforms looked great and they looked cool. And it didn't occur to me that they were doing some rather nasty things. It was all just a play game for me. And when we got to Germany, my family took a drive to Munich, and we went to visit a place called Dachau, which was a concentration camp during the war. And it was very unnerving for me at that age, because it suddenly occurred to me that these people that I knew and liked and admired almost, I'm talking about the contemporaries of the time, not only them, but the great history that Germany has, the writers, the classical music, which I'd studied all my life. I couldn't understand how this could happen. It made no sense to me. I just didn't understand it. And I remember the words written over the camp, Arbeit macht frei, which means work makes you free, which is pretty cynical and pretty ironic, considering all things considered. But it makes, what started to gradually make sense to me was that the way that you get people to do atrocious things to each other, to not only cause discomfort and pain, but to actually kill one another and to cause great suffering, is to create this idea that your opponent is not really a human being, they're the other. Ausländer, that was a word that the German propaganda ministry used often, Ausländers, which means foreigners. And you hear a lot of that these days. We hear it in Europe. We hear it in the United States all the time. And it's a way of kind of creating this idea that the people that we are against are not really human beings. And I see that kind of happening with Russia and the Russian people now. And I know that that's not true. I'm going to read you an excerpt now from a book by, a very recent book by Benjamin Abelow. It's called How the West Brought War to Ukraine, parentheses, Understanding How U.S. and NATO Policies Led to Crisis, War, and the Risk of Nuclear Catastrophe. I'm hoping to get Benjamin on the show at some point as a guest. Anyway, in his overview, he writes, for almost 200 years, starting with the framing of the Monroe Doctrine in 1823, the United States has asserted security claims over virtually the whole Western Hemisphere. Any foreign power that places military forces near U.S. territory knows it's crossing a red line. U.S. policy thus embodies a conviction that where a potential opponent places its forces is crucially important. In fact, this conviction is the cornerstone of American foreign and military policy, and its violation is considered reason for war. Yet when it comes to Russia, the United States and its allies have acted for decades and disregarded the same principle. They've progressively advanced the placement of their military forces toward Russia, even to its borders. They've done this with inadequate attention to and sometimes blithe disregard for how Russian leaders might perceive this advance. Had Russia taken equivalent actions with respect to U.S. territory, say, placing its military forces in Canada or Mexico, Washington would have gone to war and justified that as a defensive response to the military encroachment of a foreign power. When viewed through this lens, Russia's invasion of Ukraine is not seen as the unbridled expansionism of a malevolent Russian leader, but as a violent and destructive reaction to misguided Western policies, an attempt to reestablish a zone around Russia's western border that is free of offensive threats from the United States and its allies. Having misunderstood why Russia invaded Ukraine, the West is now basing existential decisions on false premises. In doing so, it is deepening the crisis and maybe sleepwalking toward nuclear war. This argument, which I now present in detail, is based on the analysis of a number of scholars, government officials, and military observers, all of whom I introduce and quote from in the presentation. These include John Mearsheimer, the late Stephen F. Cohen, Richard Sakwa, Gilbert Doctorow, George E. Kennan, Chaz Freeman, Douglas McGregor, another potential guest, and Brennan Devereaux. And his introduction says, "How the narrative drives the war." And I won't read all of it. I'll just read the first paragraph. "In the months since Russia invaded Ukraine, the explanation offered for America's involvement has changed. What had been pitched as a limited humanitarian effort to help Ukraine defend itself has morphed to include an additional aim, to degrade Russia's capacity to fight another war in the future. In fact, the strategic objective may have been in place from the start." Personally, I think it was been in place for about 8 or 9 years or maybe longer. "In March, more than a month before the new U.S. policy was announced, Chaz Freeman, previously Assistant Secretary of Defense for International Security Affairs, observed, 'Everything we are doing, rather than accelerating an end to the fighting and some compromise, seems to be aimed at prolonging the fighting, assisting the Ukrainian resistance, which is a noble cause, I suppose, but will result in a lot of dead Ukrainians as well as dead Russians.'" I'll leave it there for the time being. In other words, it's insanity. They're all crazy. The people in government are nuts. Our president is insane. And there's a very few people around him who are not also completely out of their minds. Mark Milley, perhaps one of them. Let's hope that some element of sanity prevails. I really do hope so. Anyway, I'm going to play it. This is a track. I don't read Cyrillic. I wish I did, but I don't. So I can't even tell you the name of the song, but it's by a Russian singer-songwriter named Mark Bernes. And in the effort to humanize Russians once again, I'll play this piece of music.
Хотят ли русские войны? Спросите вы у тишины. Над ширью пашины полей и у берез и тополей. Спросите вы у тех солдат, что под березами лежат. И вам ответят их сыны. Хотят ли русские? Хотят ли русские? Хотят ли русские войны? Не только за свою страну солдаты гибли в ту войну, а чтобы люди спокойно ночью спать могли. Спросите тех, кто воевал, кто вас на Эльбе обнимал. Мы этой памяти верны. Хотят ли русские войны? Да, мы умеем воевать, но не хотим, чтобы опять солдаты падали в бою на землю горькую свою. Спросите вы у матерей, спросите у жены моей, и вы тогда понять должны, хотят ли русские войны. Поймет и докер, и рыбак, поймет рабочий и батрак, поймет народ любой страны. Хотят ли русские войны?
Марк Бернес. Don't ask me, maybe Liz, if you're listening, maybe you know enough Russian to know what the song was saying. Anyway, it's probably a rather humorous and ironic take on something which Russians are very good at. I'm going to dedicate this next track to all the people out there who understand that war is not a good thing. And when I was a kid, I used to think to myself, well, what if all the soldiers just decided to not fight? What if they just said, fuck you, we're not doing it? You know, that would have been a possibility. And in fact, during the First World War, that really sort of did start happening towards the end of the war, which is one of the reasons that the greatest revolution in human history took place, which was the Russian Revolution. The Russian soldiers, along with the French soldiers, just said, we've had enough. Like, we're not going to keep doing this. The power structures that be were very, very, they vowed to never let that happen again. So here we are. Here's a track which I think really speaks to that idea of just saying, you know, kiss my ass, we're not doing this anymore. This is a track by Low Key with Kaya L'Oreal. It's called Refuse to Kill.
For those that shattered the infallibility of militarism, ye that have escaped the sword, stand not still. Banality of evil, murderous conformity, mentality is lethal. How the powerful systemize the savagery of people. There's insanity and tragedy and fallacies they feed you. This is for the Quakers that would die before they kill. Bertrand Russell in prison, he survived by force of will. Rejected by society, prefer us all concealed. History a mystery, aversion to reveal. This is the conviction Rosa Luxemburg was murdered for. This is the tradition 2003 was searching for. No time to mollycoddle, too many bodies we're sorry for. This is the feeling that stopped him loading SS Jolly George, 80 died in jail, or due to their treatment, sacrificed their lives for the most human of reasons. Monsters on the conscience, soothe illusions of freedom, the refusal to kill, a conviction you can't believe in.
I refuse to kill, I refuse to maim, I refuse to fight, no, not in my name. I refuse to kill, I refuse to maim, I refuse to fight, no, not in my name.
without a mention of parliament. Alienation targeting, afterwards it was hard for them. He considered Belgium as colonizers we can't defend. Sent to kill fellow workers by a wretched class of heartless men. Still draw the borders in places that they trample. Conscription isn't physical, but it remains financial. Participants in carnage, but from the strangest of angles. Don't prolong the mental bondage, it's time the cage is dismantled. Women's peace crusade contribution can't be forgotten. Legacy still alive and was fighting at Greenham Common. These are the real heroes, not Van Damme or Rambo. They shut the city down and banned Lloyd George from Glasgow. Better to die with honour than live life feeling guiltier. For all those that went against their families, that's Sylvia. Hope on inspiration from the legacy of Pankhurst. The next Joe Glenton could just walk away from Sandhurst.
I refuse to kill, I refuse to mend, I refuse to fight, though not my name. I refuse to kill, I refuse to mend, I refuse to fight, yeah, not my name. I refuse to kill, I refuse to mend, I refuse to fight, no, not my name. I refuse to kill, I refuse to mend, I refuse to fight, no, not my name.
He's been a soldier for 1,000 years. He's a Catholic, a Hindu, an atheist, a Jain, a Buddhist and a Baptist and a Jew. And he knows he shouldn't kill, and he knows he always will kill you for me, my friend, and me for you. And he's fighting for Canada, he's fighting for France, he's fighting for the USA, and he's fighting for the Russians, and he's fighting for Japan, and he thinks we'll put an end to war this way. And he's fighting for democracy, he's fighting for the Reds, he says it's for the peace of all. He's the one who must decide who's to live and who's to die, and he never sees the writing on the wall. But without him, how would Hitler have condemned him at Dachau? Without him, Caesar would have stood alone. He's the one who gives his body as a weapon of the war, and without him, all this killing can't go on. Is to blame. His orders come from far away no more. They come from him and you and me. And brothers, can't you see? This is not the way we put an end to
war. The hero of the war. All the neighborhood is talking about your son. Mrs. Riley, get his medals, hand them round to everyone. Show his gun to all the children in the street. It's too bad he can't shake hands or move his feet. The hero of the war. You can see his picture in the local news. Mrs. Riley seems a girl next door is nowhere to be found. Once you couldn't keep that whore from hanging round. Never mind, dear, you're with your mom once more. He's a hero of the war. like his dad who gave his life for war before. It was tragic how you almost died of pain when he was born. With no husband there beside you through it all, ring the bell if you get hungry or you fall. You're a hero of the war. Why those teardrops on your cheek? It's so absurd. Feeling empty, it's the emptiness of heroes like your son. And what made him leave his mother for a gun? Driven forward, driven back, and nothing more. He's a hero of the war.
The Hero of the War, that's Scott Walker from the album Scott 4. And nobody could scat like Scott Walker, maybe Sammy Davis Jr. would be about the only other person. And before that we heard Buffy St. Marie with the Universal Soldier, and to start that little set off with Low Key with Kaya L'Oreal, a track called Refuse to Kill. You know, there's an old saying where I come from up in Canada, fighting for peace is kind of like fucking for virginity. Ha ha. Anyway, we're just going to take a little break and we'll be right back after these messages.
¿Cómo sabes qué es lo que está pasando en Radio Kingston?
How do you know what's going on at Radio Kingston? You can tune in, go to our website, Facebook and Instagram, but did you know?
Radio Kingston tiene su propio boletín bilingüe.
Radio Kingston has its own bilingual newsletter.
Puedes enterarte en qué hemos estado trabajando.
You can find out what we've been working on.
Y aprender sobre los programas que más te gustan y los programas que todavía no conoces.
And learn more about the shows you love and shows you may want to learn more about.
También hay una versión de audio.
There's an audio version too.
¿Qué más te gustaría encontrar? Recuerda suscribirte en nuestra página web radiokingston.org.
Let us know what else you'd like to find. Go to our contact page at radiokingston.org.
Hi, I'm David McNamara from the Samadhi Recovery Community Outreach Center. We're a nonprofit organization grounded in the belief that mindfulness-based principles and practices create a strong foundation for a path to freedom from addiction. Our programs are free for the whole community and include mindfulness-based training, meditation, art therapy, trauma-informed yoga, individual and group talk sessions, holistic-based treatments, and so much more. Our offices for community outreach and peer recovery services are located at 150 Sawkill Road in Kingston, and our outpatient clinic is located at 368 Broadway, room 204. If you'd like any information about the services we offer, you can call us at 845-853-8148 or visit our website at Samadhi, SamadhiNY.org.
Hello, I'm Lindsay Wachowitz from O Positive Radio Hour, Tuesday nights at 8 here on Radio Kingston. Every October during the O Positive Festival, we exchange the art of medicine for the medicine of art. And the O Positive Radio Hour is one of the ways that we keep that mission and exchange alive all year long. Every week, we feature themes around art, music, and wellness.
With me, Sean Harrison.
And me, Jesse Shearer.
And me, Joe Conqueror.
And me, Amy Gardner.
And me, Lindsay.
And me, Lara Hope.
We speak with creative people, feature the voices and work of O Positive alumni artists, musicians, and providers, and get insights from experts in all fields. Plus, we play incredible music from our festival performers during every show. That's the O Positive Radio Hour, every Tuesday night at 8, right here on Radio Kingston, AM 1490, FM 107.9, and anytime at radiokingston.org.
And the Hudson Valley Hullabaloo is back at the Andy Murphy Neighborhood Center. You'll know the Andy Murphy Center because it's got that statue of Bill Costello in front. Saturday, November 19th and Sunday, November 20th, the Hullabaloo will feature 75 local makers, artists and designers, as well as food for purchase from Hole in the Wall and Samosa Shack. There will also be hand-drawn portraits by Thorn Eater, two unique photo booths, and music by Radio Kingston's own DJ, Mr. Chips. There's a $2 Door fee for adults and kids 12 and under are free. Masks are strongly encouraged. The Hudson Valley Hullabaloo, Saturday, November 18th from 10 a.m. to 5 p.m. and Sunday, November 20th from 10 a.m. to 4 p.m. at the Andy Murphy Neighborhood Center, 467 Broadway in Kingston. For more information, hvhullabaloo.com. And if you do go, don't forget to pat Bill Costello on the head. I'm currently, you know, I'm reading like four books at the same time all the time. But one of the books I'm reading is this excellent follow-up to his earlier book, War is a Force That Gives Us Meaning by author Chris Hedges. And the book I'm now currently reading is called The Greatest Evil is War. It's Chris Hedges' most recent book, just came out a little while ago, not that long ago. Chris was his guest on the show, and I'm just going to read a passage from his introduction where he says, Walt Whitman, who tended wounded soldiers in hospitals during the Civil War, wrote in a heading in his notebook, "The real war never gets in the books. Its interior history will not only never be written, Whitman argues, its practicality, minutiae of deeds and passions will never be even suggested. Sorry about that. War destroys all systems that sustain and nurture life, familial, economic, cultural, political, environmental, and social. Once war begins, no one, even those nominally in charge of waging war, knows what will happen, how the war will develop, how it can drive armies and nations towards suicidal folly. There are no good wars, none. This includes World War II, which has been sanitized and mythologized to celebrate American heroism, purity, and goodness. If truth is the first casualty in war, ambiguity is the second. The bellicose rhetoric embraced and amplified by the American press, demonizing Vladimir Putin and elevating the Ukrainians to the status of demigods, demanding more robust military intervention, along with the crippling sanctions designed to bring down Putin's government, is infantile and dangerous. That the inverse version of the conflict is true in the Russian media fuels the insanity. That's the answer to your question, Liz. Of course, in Russia, they're getting the opposite story, and they're convincing their young men to go fight and die. This last midterm election, which was one of the biggest ridiculous jokes. I mean, they're still counting the ballots. You know, if they were counting coins in the slot machines in Las Vegas, they'd all been counted already about 50 times over. But boy, there's 50,000 ballots in Clark County, and they can't even get them counted within 5 days. Go figure. But what was shocking and surprising to me about this last election was that the war in Ukraine and inflation, neither of those issues wasn't on the ballot. It's very strange. I mean, these are probably the two most crucial things facing not only Americans, but almost every other human being on the planet right now. Yet, there's not a peep in the media about it. Not anything. And you can really see the collusion is complete. As Chris Hedges, the corporate coup d'etat is complete. We lost. Anyway, on that cheerful note, Chris Hedges, this is for you. This is one of my favorite tracks, and I know it's one of yours. Roger Waters, Us and Them. Yes, Roger Waters, Us and Them. And if you haven't had a chance to see Roger's current live show, I highly recommend it. It's really a great thing that there are people like him of his stature and reputation that are speaking out quite vocally against the madness of not only the current war in Ukraine, but all wars and the injustices that accompany them. I just got this from Liz Hill. Liz, I love you. This is a poem. I don't even know who wrote it, but I'm going to read it to you. It says, "The Russians, do they want war? Ask the silence that hovers on our plowed fields and our plains. Ask birches, poplars. Just ask the soldiers who lie beneath the birches. Their son will tell you. The Russians, do they want? The Russians, do they want? The Russians, do they want war? It is not only for our country that soldiers fell in this war, but so that all the people of the earth can sleep peacefully at night. Just ask those who fought, to those who kissed you on the Elbe. We believe in that memory. The Russians, do they want? The Russians, do they want? The Russians, do they want war? Yes, we can fight, but we do not want soldiers to die in combat again on our saddened land. Ask our mothers, ask my wife, and then you will understand. The Russians, do they want? The Russians, do they want? The Russians, do they want war? The docker will understand, and the fisherman, the worker will understand, and the peasant, the people of each country will understand. The Russians, do they want? The Russians, do they want? The Russians, do they want war?" I think it's worth bearing in mind that during the Second World War, Russia lost more people to Nazism and fascism than all of the other countries that fought in the war combined, and that there's a big difference between the equation on their side. Currently, it's an existential situation. It's not as if, you know, we're fighting a war in Afghanistan halfway around the world. You know, imagine if we were fighting a war right on the border with Mexico. It would be a very different story.
Bei der Kaserne vor dem großen Tor steht ne Laterne und steht sie noch davor. Da wollen wir uns wiedersehen. Bei der Laterne wollen wir stehen, wie einst Lili Marleen, wie einst Lili Marleen. Unsere beiden Schatten sahen wie einer aus, dass wir lieb uns hatten, das sah man gleich daraus. Und alle Leute sollen es sehen, wenn wir bei der Laterne stehen, wie einst Lili Marleen, wie einst Lili Marleen. Deine Schritte kennt sie, deinen schönen Gang. Alle Abend brennt sie, doch mich vergaß sie lang. Und sollte mir ein Leid geschehen, wer wird bei der Laterne stehen? Mit dir, Lili Marleen, mit dir, Lili Marleen. Aus dem tiefen Raume, aus der Grund, hebt sich wie im Traume dein verliebter Mund. Wenn sich die späten Nebel drehen, wer wird bei der Laterne stehen? Mit dir, Lili Marleen, mit dir, Lili Marleen. dir Laterne stehen mit dir Nelimalen mit dir Nelimalen.
Marlene Dietrich. That was the only song during the Second World War that was a hit song on both sides, the Germans and the Allies. Very popular song. I was also just informed by Liz that the poem that I read prior to that, The Russians Do They Want, was actually the lyrics to the Mark Bernays song, which I played earlier, which I said I didn't know what it was saying. So that Mark Bernays song was called Do Russians Want War? So that's fascinating. I will just take a little break and be right back in just about, let's have a look here, a minute and a half. Stay tuned.
Hi, I'm Joanna Contreras, Acting Ulster County Executive. We're modernizing your local government. We'd like to let you know that Ulster County has a website and call center for navigating the services we provide. It's ulstercountyserves.com. For the first time, you can go online and request help and track that request until you get your answer. You can also search a knowledge base of articles on popular government services. It's a single point of contact to support you on a wide range of county government topics, from economic assistance to mental health support, to transportation, employment, and training information, and other non-emergency services. When you call 845-443-8888, you'll find trained customer service reps who can answer your questions from 9:30 a.m. to 4:30 p.m. There are also options to email us and get more information at ulstercountyserves.com.
Seasonal flu is here. Flu is a serious disease that can become fatal, and this year's flu strains are among the most virulent ever. Fortunately, you can protect yourself and your family from the flu by taking advantage of safe and effective vaccines. Everyone 6 months of age and over is eligible. Flu vaccines are available at pharmacies and doctor's offices and are covered by most insurances. Don't wait until it's too late. Get your flu vaccination today.
What was I thinking? I was thinking something anyways, but I think I might have forgot what I was thinking. Well, that happens. Anyway, one of the things that at the Roger Waters concert I saw, he said, you know, he has this new song, it's called The Bar, and it's a very long song. He plays a few verses at each show, and he basically emphasizes that we need to communicate. And I hope that for people who are listening, you know, I don't want to just be preaching to the choir, so to speak. You know, I hope that perhaps some of this gets through to the people who somehow imagine that the current conflict is a good one, and that we have to support this war, because it makes no sense when you really look at it. There's a lot of information out there to the contrary, but you have to dig deeper, and we have to keep communicating with each other. That's the most important thing. You know, there's a lot of hysteria about where people get information. Currently, there's this idea. I read something in The Atlantic just yesterday, or someone was sort of saying it's great that spaces like Facebook and Twitter are being shut down because we don't want people actually communicating with each other and speaking up and speaking out against the established media narrative, which quite honestly is mostly propaganda. In fact, it's sort of 85 to 90% propaganda. The rest is just the weather and sports. So there you go. Here's a beautiful song sung by Sinead O'Connor with the Chieftains, another anti-war song called The Foggy Dew.
Eyes down the glen, Ronnie
I want to make sure that I have enough time to play this Pink Floyd track, but I'm going to play this track called Solo Le Pido a Dios first, and then we'll do that. So here we go.
Vamos a cantar todo junto. Gracias. Okay.
One.
Vamos.
Ahora vamos a cantar dos. todos juntos, por favor.
Gracias, muchas gracias.
El
the Holocaust to come. The rusty wire that holds the cord that keeps the anger in. Gives way and suddenly it's day. The sun is in the east, even though the day is done. Two suns in the sunset. Could be the human race is run.
Roger Waters says it better than I could ever do. And with that, I bid you a fond adieu. And if the good Lord's willing and the creek don't rise, I'll see you next week. Thanks for listening. Stay tuned for Nick Pankin coming up right after this with Freedom Highway.